Hello friends, welcome to the video lectures of Internet of Things. Today's chapter of discussion is prototyping the physical design. The contents are listed on the slide. At first, product physical design seems to be unimportant. But if the Internet of Things is to succeed in reaching mass people, this lack of design is something we need to change. If you are a designer, it's great. But if you are not, then don't worry. This chapter will explore some techniques and tools to help to get started with prototyping the physical design. You can start preparation of design work of physical prototype right before the other two prototypes. All you need to do is to develop an interest in the world around you and start paying attention to different objects and different experiences that you encounter. Naturally, the more of the world you encounter, the more source material you will have to work with. As you go, collect details about the items that inspire you. Take photos, jot down the things in your notebook or sketch them out. Paste them onto a fridge or your water bottle. Whatever works best for you. Over time, you will build up an archive of good designs that will help you to spark your creativity when designing things of your own. While pen and paper remains essential tools in designing a physical design, but they aren't the only ones. There are other non-digital methods like modeling clay or Lego toy sets that you can use to design your physical prototype. One of the key advantages of using these non-digital methods is their immediate reach. Let us look at some of the more common options here. Modeling clay, which is well known as Play-Doh also. It is malleable substance. It is ideal for few type of physical prototype designs. Modeling clay is best used for short-term explorations of form rather than long-term functional prototypes. There are other non-digital methods that you can use to design your physical prototype like epoxy putty, Suguru, Lego toy construction set, cardboard, etc. The laser cutter is the best item to have in your workshop for making physical design prototype. Laser cutters range from desktop models to industrial units, which can take a full 8-inch by 4-inch sheet in one pass. Most commonly, though, they are floor standing and about the same size as a large photocopier. Most of the laser cutter is given over the bed. This is a flat area that holds the material to be cut. The bed contains two axis mechanism with mirrors and a lens to direct the laser beam to the correct location and focus it onto the material being cut. It is similar to a flat bed plotter, but one that burns things rather than drawing on them. Laser cutting is called as subtractive method as it cut off the unimportant part. The size of the bed and the power of the laser are the main features to choose your laser cutter. The file formats or software which you need to use to provide your design vary across machines and providers. Vector formats capture the drawing as a series of lines and curves, which translate much better into instructions for moving the laser cutter than the grid-like representation of a bitmap. There is also no loss of fidelity as you resize the image. With a bitmap, as you might have seen if you have ever tried blowing up a small part of a digital photo, the details become jagged as you zoom in closely. Whereas the vector format knows that it is still a single line and can redraw it with more details. CorelDRAW is a common choice for laser cutting machines. Other popular options can be Adobe Illustrator. Most of the laser cutting work is going to be like traditional cutting work, but there are some physical designs which are easy to do with laser cutting machines. For example, a lattice or hinges designs. If you are looking to introduce some curves into your design, as shown in the picture on slide, you can use a laser cutting machine well than the traditional cutting methods. as shown in picture, a series of closely laid out cuts perpendicular to the direction of the curve allows the material to be bent after it has been cut. Varying the number of cuts and their separation affects the resulting flexibility of the hinge. Similarly, there are other designs like integrated elastic clips or bolted tenon joints can be carried out well, efficient and easy with laser cutting machines rather than having it through traditional cutting methods. Another tool which is used in physical prototype designing is a 3D printing. This is called as additive manufacturing method. The term additive manufacturing is used because all the various processes which can be used to produce the output start with nothing and add material to build up the resulting model. This is in contrast to subtractive manufacturing techniques such as laser cutting and CNC milling, where you start with more material and cut away the parts you don't need. 3D printing produces items which wouldn't be possible with traditional techniques. For example, if you want to make interlocking rings without any joints, you will not be able to do it with any other technology than the 3D printing. Lots of innovations are still happening in the world of additive manufacturing, but here are a few more common methods of 3D printing which are used today. The first method is fused filament fabrication, FFF, also known as fused deposition modeling, FDM. It works by extruding a fine filament of material, usually plastic, from a heated nozzle. The nozzle can be moved horizontally and vertically by the controlling computer. The resulting models are quite robust as they are made from standard plastic. Second method is of laser sintering. This process is sometimes called selective laser sintering or electron beam melting or direct metal laser sintering. It is used in more industrial machines but can print any material which comes in powdered form and which can be melted by a laser. It provides a finer finish than FDM, but the models are just as robust and they are even stronger when the printing medium is metal. This technique is used to print aluminium or titanium, although it can just as easily print nylon. Laminated object manufacturing, LOM, is another method which can produce full color prints. LOM uses traditional paper printing as part of the process. Because it builds up the model by laminating many individual sheets of paper together, it can print whatever colors are required onto each layer before cutting them to a shape and gluing them into a place. The next method of 3D printing is stereolithography and digital light processing. It is possibly the oldest 3D printing technique. This approach builds their models from a vat of liquid polymer resin, which is cured by exposure to ultraviolet light. Stereolithography uses a UV laser to trace the pattern for each layer, whereas digital light processing uses a DLP projector to cure an entire layer at a time. As similar to laser cutting softwares, there is no definite software package that is recommended to generate 3D designs. Tinkercad and Autodesk's 123D design online are two options which just run in your browser, so they let you start designing without having to install any additional software. SolidWorks, Reno or SketchUp are another softwares which can be used to make 3D designs. When you have your design ready, you need a further piece of software to convert it into a set of instructions which will be fed to the printer. This is usually known as a slicing algorithm software because its most important function is to carve the model into a series of layers and work out how to instruct the printer to build up each layer. CNC means computer numerically controlled milling is similar to 3D printing, but it is a subtractive manufacturing process rather than additive. The CNC part just means that A computer controls the movement of the milling head, much like it does the extruder in an FDM of 3D printer. Because cutting away material is easier, CNC mills can work with much greater range of materials than 3D printers can. CNC mills can also be used for more specialized tasks like creating custom printed circuit boards, etc. Different types of CNC mills are available. Bigger is not always better, though. The challenges of accurately moving the carriage around increase with their size. CNC mills can often achieve resolutions of order 0.001 millimeter, which is a couple of orders of magnitude better than the current generation of low-end 3D printers. In 2.5 axis CNC mill, it has three axes of movements X, Y, and Z. It can move only any two at one time. In case of 4 axis CNC milling, this machine adds a rotary axis to the 3 axis mill to allow the piece being milled to be rotated around an extra axis. As 3D printing technique have different software, CNC milling also have two main types of softwares. The first is CAD, called computer aided design. The second is CAM, which is computer aided manufacturing. CAD software let you design the model, and CAM software turns that into a suitable toolpath. While designing a physical prototype for your connected thing, it is not always necessary to purchase all these machines and softwares of your own. You can take these machines on rent and you can carry out your physical design prototype work. Reusing mechanisms or component is always economical. If part of your product or entire sub-assembly that you need to design in your product is already available in market, then it is better to buy rather than making it in-house. So this chapter provided you with a good grounding in building a physical prototype of your Internet of Thing device. Moving ahead to the next chapter, it is prototyping online components. The contents that we are going to discuss are listed in the slide. With physical design and embedded controller of sensors and actuators, you have already made a clever thing, but such thing can be called as embedded systems. Internet of Things are way different than the embedded systems. As we know, to make an Internet of Thing, three things are fundamental. The first is physical design, second, the electronics which make the thing smart, and third, the internet connectivity. The internet adds a dimension of communication. The network allows the device to inform you or others about events or to gather data and let you act on it in real time. If you want your Internet of Thing to connect to the internet, you need to use a web service, which is provided by application programming interface called APIs. API is a way of accessing a service that is targeted at machines rather than people. Sometimes the data you want is already available on internet, but in the form that doesn't work for you. Here you can use multiple APIs to get that data in your compatible format. There are two concerns related to API. First is scrapping, and the next is legalities. Scrapping is the process of collecting screen display data from one application and translating it so that another application can display it. Such screen scrappings may break the terms and conditions of a website. Even if you don't think about legal sanctions, breaking the terms and conditions for a company may lead to the denial of other services to you. If you don't want to use the pre-existing APIs, there is another option, and that is you can write a new API for your Internet of Thing. The process of building your own API is explained with the example of this case study of Clocodillo. This is an Internet of Thing device that is built to help to use Pomodoro time management technique. The technique uses a timer to break down work into intervals, traditionally 25 minutes in length, separated by short breaks. These intervals are named Pomodoros, the plural in English of the Italian word pomodoro, that is tomato. Locodillo is a simple kitchen timer with internet connectivity to make tracking easier while keeping simplicity in physical design. The next concern is security. How important security is depends a lot on how sensitive the information being passed is and whether it is in anyone's interest to compromise it. For Clocodillo, perhaps a boss might want to double check that employees are using the timer, or a competitor might want to check the descriptions of the task to spy what your company is working on. If your Internet of Things is giving service which deals with health or financial information, it may be an even more attractive target. Location information is also sensitive. Burglars might find it convenient to know when you are out of your house. Whenever you are requesting for any web service, your request has to pass the details to identify the user, which is the problem of identity. You have to consider the risk in sending the identification or authentication data over the internet. If the username and password are in clear text, they can be read by anyone who is snipping that packet. In case of other web services than Internet of Things, if a software password is compromised, a website can easily provide a way of changing that password. But while a computer has a monitor and keyboard to make that task easy, an internet connected device may not have a monitor or keyboard connected to it. Most of the Internet of Things run a headless setup, which means they don't have a keyboard or mouse to interact with the system. And therefore, your password should be strong enough, which will be very hard to guess by the malicious users. There are two main cases which needs to be considered while talking about security. The first is someone who is targeting a specific user and has access to that person's wired or wireless network. This attacker could read the details and use them maliciously. Secondly, someone who has access to one of the intermediate nodes. These person won't be targeting a specific device, but may be looking to see what unencrypted data passes by to see what will be a tempting target. One solution for this is, instead of sending clear text password, we can encrypt the whole request, including the authentication details. Here is the revised table of Clocodillo API. This table is also have additional authentication like MAC address, username and password. There are different standards for implementing the API. An API defines the messages that are sent from client to server and from server to client. We can send data in whatever format we want, but it is almost always better to use an existing standard because convenient libraries will exist for both client and server to produce and understand the required messages. Few of the most common standards that we'll consider are Representational State Transfer REST, JSON RPC, XML RPC, and Simple Object Access Protocol SOAP. REST standard access a set of web URLs using HTTP methods such as GET and POST. The result is often XML or JSON. JavaScript Object Notation, that is JSON, is a way of formatting data so that it can be easily exchanged between different systems. There are some parameters that one should consider when deciding on a platform for a web backend. These parameters can be concluded by asking questions like, what do you already know? That means whether you are planning to develop code yourself. What is the local or internet recruiting market like? That means if you're going to planning to outsource, or is the language is thriving? Is it actively developed? Does it have a healthy community? Or is there any rich ecosystem of libraries available for this language? You can use Perl language to code the backend, and you can use curl to test. Curl simply makes an HTTP request and prints out the result to a terminal. Sometimes the data structure that you are using to store individuals' data need to be expanded. This example also triggers the architectural features that we need to consider. API rate limiting is one of that. If the service becomes popular, managing the number of connections to the site becomes critical. Setting a maximum number of calls per day or per hour or per minute might be useful. A software application can easily warn users that their usage limit has been exceeded and they should try later. The API currently serializes the output only in JSON, XML, and text format. You might want to connect from a web browser also. This can be done through the different API designs. You can split API into two tasks, one that device can do and the other that the web service or platform can do. One should note that not every Internet of Things product needs a browser application. Perhaps the API is all you need, with maybe a static home page containing some documentation about how to call the API. In the case of Clockodilo, however, we do want to have a set of web pages to interact with. Users should be able to look at their timers, assign descriptions, and so on. Although text-based APIs are more prominently used in Internet of Things, you can easily have an elegant and well-designed application for humans to interact with. For example, as displayed in the figure, this figure shows a static login page. This page is entirely for the convenience of human. All the labels like your email address and the help text like remember your password is a case sensitive are purely there to guide the user. The traditional sort of APIs are making an HTTP request to the server and receive a response. This can be disadvantageous if you want a very responsive system. If you want to perform an action the instant that something happens on your board, you may have to factor in the connection time. If the server has to perform an action immediately, that immediately could be nearly a minute later, depending on the connection time. We can look at two options here, polling and the commit technologies. If I want the device or another client to respond immediately, how should I do that? Because we don't know when the event that we are responding will happen. The traditional way of handling this kind of situations is using HTTP API request is to make request at regular intervals. This is called polling. We might make a call every minute to check whether new data is available for us. However, this means that we can't start to respond until the poll returns. So this might mean a delay of 1 minute plus the time to establish the HTTP connection. We can make this quicker polling every 10 seconds, but this would put load on internet. To deal with such problems, there is another standard called COMET. This can be used in real-time reactions more efficiently. COMET is an umbrella name for a set of technologies developed to get around the inefficiencies of polling. There are three ways of doing it. The first is long polling, which is unidirectional. The second is multi-part XML HTTP request MXHR, which is also unidirectional. And the third is HTML5 WebSockets, which is bidirectional technique. As with many technologies, many of them were developed before the brand of COMET was invented. There are other protocols which can be used while implementing the web platform for your Internet of Things. One of that is MQTT, which stands for Message Queuing Telemetry Transport. It is a lightweight publish and subscribe system where you can publish and receive messages as a client. MQTT is a simple messaging protocol designed for constrained device with low bandwidth. So it's the perfect solution for Internet of Things applications. MQTT allows you to send commands to control outputs, read and publish data from sensor nodes and much more. Therefore, it makes it really easy to establish a communication between multiple devices. Initially, it was published by IBM, but later it made as an open standard. Another protocol to consider is Extensible Messaging and Presence Protocol. This is both a blessing and a curse. It is well understood and widely developed, but because it wasn't designed explicitly for use in embedded applications, it uses XML to format the messages. There is one more protocol standard that can be considered while developing the web platform as a backend to your Internet of Things is Constraint Application Protocol. The Constraint Application Protocol, COAP, is designed to solve the same classes of problems as HTTP, but for networks without TCP. There are proposals for running COAP over UDP, SMS mobile phone messaging. COAP draws many of its design features from HTTP and has defined mechanism to proxies to allow mapping from one protocol to other protocol. This chapter helped to understand the network side of Internet of Things and how to interact with existing services either through published APIs or via web scraping.